The Center for Educational Media and the College of Education at Middle Tennessee State University are proud to offer professional development to K-12 educators in Tennessee through our online video library. The following video is presented by the Center for Educational Media in partnership with Professional Educators of Tennessee's Leader U Conference. For more professional development videos, check out our website at www.mtsu.edu/CEM.
Hello, I'm Carolyn Marino. I am the Board Secretary for Professional Educators of Tennessee, and we're so glad you're here today. I'd like to introduce a very special guest. We have Daniel Zander, and I know I'm not going to say it quite as cool as your accent would, but he's a producer and creative writer based out of the UK. He's worked for organizations like Syco, spelled S-Y-C-O, on projects such as X Factor and Britain's Got Talent, and has a Bachelor of Arts with honors and a Master of Arts in Production. Daniel has also helped to lead some of the UK's biggest music initiatives for youth with the charity TUFF. T-U-F-F, Tough Earth, and continues to promote the use of creativity in the classroom as well as mental health awareness. Thank you so much for being here today. We're so glad.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Yeah, so my name is Daniel Zander, and I'm a producer, actually a record producer, but I'm also a creative director. So I work with artists on campaigns. So we sort of put brands together. I bring in photographers, video directors, and we sort of put packages around artists. But my career really goes right back to when I was in school. And when I was in school, I lived in a relatively deprived area, a place just outside Liverpool called Birkenhead. And there wasn't a lot of money in the area. The schools didn't have a great deal of money, so like the teachers had to try and be as creative as possible. But one thing that the local council did was it ensured that all students got access to music. And I was fortunate to be given a trumpet and a trombone, much to my mother and father's horror, I must say. But it really did sort of inspire my mind to be able to play music coming from an underprivileged community. Like, it was something like for me to have this big brass instrument, it was really exciting. And, you know, after going through sort of music theory and learning, I then became part of something called the Wirral Youth Orchestra. And that allowed me to sort of meet with other people, other like minds, and sort of synthesize ideas that I had around music with other people my age, and go through sort of a process that was very different to what I found in school. In school, it was all about sort of conformity. It was about rules. It was about regulations. But whereas within music, it was a completely different framework. It was designed, in my mind, looking back now, to sort of really sort of planting seeds. It was like this ability that I had to be able to write these melodies and collaborate with other people and then take all that we'd created and be able to perform in front of other people. And you'd think I'd like that, but even studying now, I'm quite nervous doing it. Like, I don't think you ever quite get over the nerves of standing in front of people. But I think it's really important in terms of creativity, because as the title of the slide says there, I really am interested in inspiring minds through creativity and collaboration, but through convergence at the same time. You know, Albert Einstein said, creativity is intelligence having fun. And I really do believe that. Just going around the room, what do people think in terms of creativity? Like, what does creativity mean to you? Have we got any volunteers? No. Yeah.
The first thought that comes to my mind is I'm not a creative person. I don't feel creative, but then I have to remember it's not necessarily crafts, because I'm not at all arts, crafts. I teach middle school.
Yeah.
Not at all arts, craft, but I teach social studies and I try real hard to be creative in it, and actually with music. So any song that has some sort of historical meaning or message or is about gets in played in my room.
Amazing. So there's a strong link with like art and music.
I try.
Yeah. Anyone else? Yeah.
Well, I've kind of lost my voice a little bit, but I really, for me, like, well, I have a background in arts too. So it's just about bringing like what's on the inside, on the outside, and like using different outlets and being able to, when you don't have the words or you do have the words, like whatever you need to express yourself to get your soul out on the outside.
Yeah. Yeah, really good. And I totally agree with both of those points. I think, but creativity for me, it doesn't sort of stop at art. It doesn't stop at music. You know, creativity can go into so many different fields. And really, it's this idea of, as you say, bringing something on the inside, this sort of infinite depth of sort of wisdom, potential knowledge, ideas, and sort of all of that type of stuff, and bringing it outside of ourselves in whatever format we think of. In terms of the creative mind in that regard, the reason I think it's so important in terms of collaboration and convergence is because, yes, we can bring these things from inside of us outside of ourselves, but what benefit does that really bring to the world and to other people? And more to the point, what really does it mean to create? To create, in terms of the definition, is to bring into existence out of nothing, to originate, to make. The act of creating, any original production of the human mind. And I think in schools, and especially as teachers, we work with children who are incredibly creative little beings. You know, they're not going to be defined. It's very hard to contain them. All they really want to do is create. And we live in a completely different world now than maybe we did 10 years ago. And we've got access to computers, mobile phones. I'm guessing probably 90%, if not more, of children now probably spend most evenings on their tablets, constantly learning. And it may not be information that we think is necessarily valuable, but there is synthesis in that in a different context, which we'll come to later. So we've looked at creativity and we've looked at the definition of what it means to create, but what is convergence then, and why is it important? What do we think of when we think of convergence? Another volunteer? Yeah.
Like bringing different ideas that maybe aren't related to create something new, or a new way of thinking, a new way of looking at something.
Exactly, yeah. So it's the convergence. It could be convergence of ideas. It could be the convergence of fields within, you know, disciplines within education, for example. There's a graphic here, which is a good example of convergence, talking about the tablets again that children are using. You know, if you go right back, you know, we used to have a separate phone. I remember when I was a kid, we'd have a house phone, you know, and every, you know, you'd wait and the house phone would ring and everyone would run to the house phone and try and answer a phone call. You wouldn't know who it'd be, who the phone call would be for, or what they were calling about. Then you'd have a separate television. You'd have a VHS player and maybe a Blu-ray player and a DVD player and a VHS player. But it took incredibly creative minds to be able to synthesize those things, to be able to get to the modern day where we are now, where we have tablets, for example. People like Steve Jobs with Apple. You know, Dr. Talwar and Pam Lewis earlier were talking about this concept of having a mobile phone or a watch. But actually, Steve Jobs came up with the answer. It's called the Apple Watch. And this occurred through creative, collaborative convergence. The convergence was in the field, the creativity was in Steve Jobs, and the collaboration was the team of people that he worked with to deliver the project. This really is no different than in schools. A hunch is creativity trying to tell you something, Frank Capra. Obviously, we have to use a musician. If we just take a second, I'd like to come up with a fourth word that connects the first three, and we'll go around the room, because although these might not seem linked at all, you know, it doesn't really matter what we come up with, it's more about the exercise. So the first one, we've got time, hair, stretch. Someone going to come up with a fourth word? Anna, I can see you smiling. And I know Anna, by the way, this is Anna Pryor, a co-founder of Tuff.
I was actually still... This is the mind, okay? I was actually still on hair, stretch, bleach. Sorry.
Bleach, okay, hair, stretch, bleach. Manners, round, tennis, table. Ache, hunter, cabbage.
Head.
What was that?
Head, a headache, head hunter, head of cabbage.
Exactly, okay, yeah, you get it. But, and... And this is the idea. It's like, you know, creativity and the synthesis of ideas and this idea of collaborating with other people. Creativity, it doesn't exist within bounds. You know, Einstein said, imagination is more powerful than knowledge. And I'd completely agree with that. And he goes on further. I'm enough of an artist to draw freely on imagination, he said. Imagination is more important than knowledge. Knowledge is limited. Imagination encircles the world. And that was in an interview in 1929. So teaching creativity then. As you know, students cannot be taught to be creative any more than seeds can be taught to grow. But what we can do is we can create the conditions in the classroom for the seeds in the mind of our students to grow. And I think this is the key to a successful classroom. It's about creating an environment that the children not only feel comfortable enough to express themselves and express who they are. And it doesn't have to just be artistically. This can be expressing themselves through mathematics, through engineering, through sciences. Creativity, though, is no excuse for sloppy thinking. People think that creative people and artistic people are sort of in some way not as focused as maybe some of the other disciplines that rely on things like logic, you know, sciences, engineering, it's maths based. But in actual fact, one thing that I know from working in the music industry is some of the most intelligent people I've met are actually composers. Because if you think of music, really, it is just a matter of frequency and ratio. It's just that the difference in understanding and interpreting that is through the ears and through feeling of emotion, as opposed to the eyes and working mental arithmetic. It's actually using similar areas of the brain, just in a completely different way. Here's a little challenge that's kind of highlights the problem here. On the table, you've got a couple of objects. You've got a box of nails, you've got a candle, and you've got a box of matches. And the challenge here is to affix the lit candle to the wall so that it won't drip wax onto the table below. Can anyone think of how we would best be able to do this challenge? Let's say he has to stay lit for the...
I could affix my thing with it and make the light go out, but...
My first thing would, I'm not sure if it would work, but break the candle.
Okay.
Still gonna stay together because of the wick, but break it third from the bottom. Light the candle, affix the bottom to the wall, then use a tack or a nail to make it go straight up. But then I got that far. Instead, it's still gonna drip on the table. So that's as far as I got.
Has anyone else got any ideas?
Affix it to the edge of the table and then it'll drip on the floor.
Yeah. Okay, it is a bit of a challenging one, but it's kind of misleading at the same time, because the answer is actually it only requires two tacks or two nails. It's that the idea of the other ones were kind of a distraction in the problem. You put one tack through the box into the wall to affix the box to the wall, and put the other one into the bottom of the candle to fix that, light it, and obviously the wax will drip into the tray. But it counts, and that was a problem-solving exercise developed by Carl Duncker in 1945. But it kind of, it addresses this issue where in today's day and age, and I think someone alluded to it when we were talking before about people are seeing a big change in young children now and the approach to learning that they have. And I think this is because children nowadays, as you know, have just got this complete overload mountain of information. And they don't really know kind of how to deal with it in their own minds, but you feel it as teachers, I'm sure, in the classroom. It can be disrupting. You know, kids don't necessarily want to conform. They don't want to sit there and just write on a piece of paper because they're so used to having that iPad where they've got access to all this information. They don't really see the point when Google can provide them with the answer. To go a step further than that, there's now an application that Microsoft and Google have developed, as you may know or may not, called Bard, which is an application that basically uses artificial intelligence. They've combined all of the information that is available on the internet into one massive database. And that database has been pooled together so that Bard is able to answer any question you put in it. And if that question was, can you write me an essay on a particular subject and make it 2,000 words, Bard would be able to do it. So many of the students now, when you're setting assignments and they're going away, how can we say that Bard isn't actually writing the essay? Has anyone in here had any experiences of students who've actually come in and you've had an inclination that they didn't write that particular piece of work? Well, now plagiarism's gone to a whole new level because you can literally go to a website. I think there's one called OpenAI, there's Bard. You can go on and put in your question and it will write the essay for you. You can then take the essay out of that and put it through another algorithm in AI that'll paraphrase it for you.
So is it writing its own essay though?
It's pulling from algorithms.
It's pulling from algorithms, yeah.
But if it's writing an original essay, it's still not the child, but that would be real, that does change plagiarism to a huge level. It's...
Yeah, yeah. So it's taking the, and it's randomized at the same time.
Right, so I couldn't put it into a
you wouldn't
plagiarism
be able to
checker,
check plagiarism,
wouldn't find it.
No, because there's no way of actually being able to do that. But some people would look at it and go, on the face of it, well, that's terrible. How do we, going forward, how are we going to ensure that there isn't plagiarism going on with essays? But the question I'm asking is actually, is this just evolution? Is this the next step? Should we mark, should, you know, let's say, for example, a child delivers an A-star essay and use this particular methodology that I'm describing now, would we mark them down for the plagiarism or would we mark them up for the creative aspect that they've been able to go on and do the research to understand what Bard is, know how to input the data, know how to export it as a Word document, transfer it, and then try to trick you as teachers? I mean, there is a lot of sort of creativity in that aspect in itself. But a little bit wider than that, it's ironic because Although two-thirds of society think that creativity is valuable to society, only one in four people actually believe that they're reaching their creative potential. And I think this is really the problem, is that people don't feel creative because creativity is associated, as you outlined before, with the arts, with music, with craft making. But actually, as Steve Jobs showed with Apple, creativity is about STEM subjects as well. It's about science, technology, engineering, and maths. But if we take it even further, it's STEAM. Because if we add art into STEM, then we get a more encompassing 360-degree picture. So teaching creativity then. Why should we encourage creativity in the classroom? Just go to you guys for a second. Why do you think it's important for creativity in the classroom in terms of your experience with children?
They're more involved.
They're more involved, yeah. Engagement. This is sort of alluding to that collaborative effort. Anyone else? Yeah.
I think it's super important to connect the why. Why do I need to learn this? Why is this important? How is this applicable to my life? And
yeah.
Stuff like that.
But also I think creativity, I mean, we spoke about it before, it's bringing something inside yourself, isn't it, outside? And I think when you bring something from inside yourself outside and you bring it into the world, I think a lot of kids are more passionate about seeing that come through to fruition because it was their idea, it was their, you know, it was their concept. You know, they brought this to the table. It's something to be proud of.
I don't throw you off. You mentioned Steve Jobs, but have y'all watched his commencement address at Stanford? I mean, it amazes me how many people had watched it.
Who was the speaker?
Steve Jobs.
Steve Jobs was speaker.
I mean, how many? So nobody's seen it.
Well,
the reason I'm asking this is I've asked teachers this question, and nobody knows. It just amazes me. But if you watch what he says in there, it's almost prophetic. He talks about how he hated school. He was hanging out with the Hare Krishnas to eat pizza.
Yeah.
And he was living on the floors of the dorms with his friends. And he popped out of the class he didn't like, started popping the class he did like. He got in a calligraphy class. That's how he says he learned it. If I'm not mistaken, coding.
Yeah.
But it's pretty cool. Y'all ought to watch the commencement address.
No, I totally, yeah. I think it is. And just another one. I mean, Simon Cowell, obviously the guy that I work with, very similar situation. University dropout, left, wasn't interested in it, went through a very similar thing. I think he was 36 when he actually lost everything. And he went back to his parents' home with £5 in his pocket, which paid for his taxi, and started again. So you do see this sort of, and I think it raises an important point, actually. Creativity and being destructive or self-destructive, these two things are sort of, we see them as polar opposites. But in my experience, the more creative someone can become, the more destructive they can become as well at the same time. So maybe there is a correlation actually between this mental health pandemic that we're seeing and the overloading of information where we're sort of taking all this information in and we're not able to sort of digest it and get it back out again. So we just continue to consume.
I was just thinking, to add on to your comment, really it's about connecting the child closer to themselves.
Yeah.
It's about giving them the opportunity, the space, the openness, the pause with which to do that and explore things, even if it was growing whatever that is, bougainvillea or whatever. It gives them that opportunity to know, to get closer to know who they are. And that's what's missing.
Yeah.
That's why we had so many lost, depressed kids.
And that's the sort of the second point there on the slide about this, the opposite of creativity being repression. I mean, the diagram, obviously, that Anna, you allude to with this sort of trellis and the clematis growing up. I chose that image because for me, it's really symbolic of the human mind. Like creativity is, it doesn't have any bounds. Like Einstein said, imagination can go anywhere. Whereas school is about, it's about discipline, it's about order, it's about, you know, there are aspects of school which are the opposite of the imagination and creativity. But like the clematis here, it can only grow, or imagination can only flourish when it has a framework, when it has something that it can be bound to. And I think there are a lot of answers like this. I always look to nature to find these sorts of answers, but I think creativity is something that really does need a structure. And I think that's why school is so important. I think that's why you as teachers, as Shemenda pointed out before, as sort of heroes of the classroom, it really is so important to sort of nurture that creativity, but doing it in a way that is ordered, that provides that framework. And the more students practice, obviously, the more creative they'll be. I think for me, in my career, I started off as an engineer, actually, in the studio. I started working in my career, I started working for two songwriters called Chris and Tony Griffiths, who wrote the first Oasis album. And they also wrote for Cher. I think the song, Do You Believe in Life After Love, which was a very creative song because it was one of the first ones that they actually used the auto tune on. I then went on and worked for people such as Andy McCluskey from a band called Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark, if some of you know who those are, a European band. But yeah, my career started in engineering, really, and then I started getting exposure to songwriters, different aspects of music. And it was through that period that I thought, actually, I'm really interested in starting to, you know, to write and produce my own. And I thought, well, what if I synthesized that knowledge with the knowledge I'd acquired in school in terms of music theory? Well, I've got a bit of songwriting. I've worked with some of the top songwriters who've given me some amazing tips. I've got the knowledge in terms of music theory to be able to create chord progressions and melodies. And I've got the engineering skills to be able to record it myself. So I wasn't reliant on anyone else. And it was only because of my creative mind being able to synthesize these different aspects that I thought, okay, I can actually start to do this and start to produce other people. So then I started working with artists who I would later, you know, bring into X Factor, like Anthony Russell, for example, or Becky Hill, who went on to have a series of number ones, or now the Mysterines, who've just had a top 10 album. So for me, it really was all about the synthesis of ideas and different disciplines and experience that I had through my life that allowed me to continue to succeed in what it was that I wanted to do. I came to a point where when I was working for Psycho and I was looking for talent, what I was really looking for was the, or to use a pun, was the X factor. I was looking for something different, something that would inspire other people. And I'd come through all of these different sort of rungs in my career, and you know, the engineering, the songwriting, the production, and I'd pulled all these together. And I realized that a lot of artists, they didn't know anything about, you know, we're moving into a new era, they didn't know anything about web design, they didn't know anything about, you know, creating artwork, this, that, and the other. So I thought, well, I've got to start to understand these things because I've got to be able to advise artists and interact with photographers and video makers. And I had to understand all these different things. Didn't need to become an expert in each individual field, but I did need to know enough about each of those fields to have a conversation, to be able to verbalize and communicate what it was that I was looking for. And it was then, after working for Psycho and X Factor, that I was approached by the Unity of Faith Foundation. And the reason I'm telling you this is because it's a really good example of how a creative mind can synthesize these ideas to achieve one's goal. Because with working with TUF, we've created what NBC, or may have been ABC, have just called the world's largest music-based mental health initiative in the world. Last year, we had over 20,000 submissions from over 35 countries around the world. Or ask for your music. And there's Siri being incredibly creative at the wrong time. but yeah, so we had over 20,000 submissions from 35 countries around the world, and we supported over 3,500 people with mental health needs. But the reason I'm making that point is if I hadn't have had the experience in the engineering and the production and the web design and the photography, you know, the project would have been so expensive to deliver, we never would have been able to get it off the ground. So I work with the team to help develop the website. We worked with the artists to bring them in to work on the photography and the graphic design and this and that. And, you know, there's so much encompassing in a project like that. But we did it internally with a relatively small team. So the world's largest music-based mental health initiative only came because of the learning through our lives and the knowledge that we'd acquired and the synthesis of it, which is exactly what happens really on a micro level with the students in a classroom. It's synthesizing these different disciplines. And what I'm really interested in sort of discussing with you today is how do we encourage that? And you guys know best. You know, just a couple of audience members, do you want to talk about a couple of examples of, you know, cases in class where you've had students, where you've encouraged them to be creative?
I'll start. I work with special needs children. So I go into the classroom inclusion, I push in for that because we're a STEM school, science, technology, engineering, and math. Two students are put together to collaborate on creating a roller coaster. They're given straws, paper plates, and I don't know what else, but they had to take the materials that were in front of them, they had to create a roller coaster that made one turn and then drop a ping pong ball from that roller coaster into a cup. These are two students who are in my intervention class who don't work well together. They don't work well with anyone together. So I just stood back and I watched and I listened, I asked questions, and they were able to create, the two of them, a roller coaster that on the first try dropped the ping pong ball into the cup. You would have thought they had won the Nobel Peace Prize. They were so excited about that. And I think my point is, special needs children of all people need to know that they can be creative too. That may be their only area where they shine. Yeah. They may not be able to read well, they may not be able to do math well, but they can create things. And I think that was the biggest thing for them to learn that day is, I am worth something and I can create something. So I just want to bring that out.
That's a really good example. Oh, thank you for that.
Daniel, I just want to make a point. It's really important from what you said.
Yeah.
If you look at three people who've made a big difference on the planet from different, you know, like genres or like your different, industries. So you mentioned Simon Cowell. Everyone knows who Simon Cowell is. You know, he's made The X Factor, AGT, for example. You know, and all these music, American Idol, it's all Simon Cowell. What education does Simon Cowell have? Now, he always says you don't need an education to basically become what I become. Richard Branson, Virgin Atlantic, you know, many Virgin hotels. Again, another school dropout. Again, what happened? Creativity. Steve Jobs, we just talked about Steve Jobs just now. Again, creativity. But what if that we lead a pathway, like Daniel said, like look at it. Look, this is Dan. Dan is a fine example of someone who was nurtured through school with their teachers, given the pathway, and he is where he is now. And this way, instead of people like Steve Jobs and Simon Cowell and Richard Branson saying, oh, we don't need education, we find the next Simon Cowell, the next Richard Branson, the next Steve Jobs, Daniel Zander, who says education needed, but you know what? I needed that lift. If we all give that lift to all the children out there, then we have a different dynamics of how people look at education, how children look at education, how parents look at education. So I commend you, Daniel. Well done for
thanks,
that.
Thanks, Dr. Talwa.
Good question. Did you, okay, we came in a little bit late, sorry about that. Did you talk about, which I only found out yesterday, that you were given a trumpet at school? You were in a regular state school?
Yeah.
You did talk about that?
Yeah, no, I talked about that. And that was kind of a little bit of the order that came through my school. But I mean, just to touch on what you were saying there, Dr. Talwa, I think I was not an easy student to work with, let me tell you. I was a nightmare. Like, I did not want to sit in class and learn about algebra, quadratic equations, you know, what happens when you put, you know, sulfuric acid on limestone. You know, I really didn't want to be there and didn't want to learn that because for me, you know, I was, one thing about me when I was younger is I've got a very, very strong relationship with my family and my grandparents, and my nan made sure that I had a computer from a very early age. So I had a computer, I think I was one of the first, about, you know, 12, I was one of the first in my class to have a computer. And I used to be very creative on that as well. I used to make my own certificates and print them out and give them to me nan. And she'd be, this is fantastic, you've won what? So I was getting lots of acclaim from a very early age, but it's just a really good example of like how my mind was working back at that time. But it was very divergent, which incidentally brings me on to the next point, divergent thinking. You know, as a divergent thinker, you know, what does that really mean? I mean, it represents the potential for creative thinking and problem solving, but it's not synonymous with the actual creative behavior, but has proven to be a good estimate of it. It's also useful as a construct or empirical research on creativity and in various applied settings. So if we think of it, the difference between this idea of convergent thinking and divergent thinking, you know, convergent thinking is being logical, is being ordered. You know, it's that aspect of the mind, if we call it left brain, right brain, for example. And divergent thinking is about intuition, is about creativity, is about thinking outside of the box, whatever that means for the individual. But how does that relate to children? Well, all children, in my opinion, have creative abilities. Every single child in the class has a creative ability. The difference between one child succeeding with that creative ability and another child not succeeding with their creative ability is really massively impacted by you, the teacher. Because if it wasn't for me having such good teachers in school and being given the attention that I was and given the instruments, I wouldn't be stood here speaking to you people today. So I think it really is about sort of working with the children in the class to find out each individual child's desire. What is it they want to do? What's the passion? What's their spark? Schools are thinly disguised conspiracy to quash creativity. You know, this is what students think. They genuinely believe. I mean, I grew up believing this. She's got it out for me, eh? You know, she's trying to stop me. But the irony was, it was that thought in my mind that drove me to want to do more. Creativity is taught out of the students. This is that idea of being, you know, this is, you know, it comes from the inside out. You know, it's something that's taught out. It's something that we need to bring out. And to be creative, one must be willing to take a chance and maybe be wrong. I think it was Einstein who said, Show me a man or woman who's never failed, and I'll show you a man or woman who's never lived. You know, we only grow really through failure. And not only is it okay to fail, it should feel good to fail. And it's better to fail together with other people in a class rather than failing and being identified on your own and singled out. This is where this idea of collaboration comes from. I think individual learning is great because it can be tailored. But in a class setting, what's really great about it is the fact that if you can go back to your classroom and create exercises where you know the students are going to fail, like the diagram before, it's so hard. I mean, who's going to think to get two nails out of the box and put it in the wall realistically? But if we do create those experiences where people learn to fail together, and that in order to achieve together, they have to work together, I think it encourages the right types of behaviors, because that's certainly what worked for me. Winston Churchill once said, success is walking from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm. And whether you like Winston Churchill or not, he's a very contentious character. He did achieve some incredible things. And I think that quote really does kind of define what he did in World War II by overcoming an oppressive force, which is the opposite to being creative, liberty, freedom. Pam?
You know, Daniel, I think to your point, we talked about kids failing and the sky doesn't have to fall. In other words, okay, get up, brush yourself off and go on. That teaches resilience. If you are resilient, you're going to be less likely to have mental problems, to have adjustment issues, and to have mental illness. So it's all tied together with the theme of what TUP is all about.
It is.
Teaching resilience. It's teaching a can-do attitude.
Yeah, and I think if people, we do have a resilience program actually, which was developed by Dr. Talwar, which is Tough Resilience, which is something we work with children in schools. It's about giving them the resilience and giving them the skills to, you know, overcome challenges of adversity, for example. But I think likewise, obviously, with the relationships that you have with the children in your own classes, it's about not letting those children filter your creativity, because I think it's about leading by example, isn't it? You know, can we just take a second just to go through back through the audience again, just to talk a little bit about some examples of, like, you know, what you've done to try and inspire creativity in your classroom? Yeah.
I also teach English language arts, and one of the hardest things, especially for on-level students, not the honors class, is vocabulary and having them understand you do need to have direct teaching of vocabulary. A lot of teachers just have them do the work in a book or something, and I always made them have to do something. Well, I had a class where I was being observed, so I was trying to be creative. And I took the words, and they knew they were allowed to look at the words and then look at the definitions, because I wasn't expecting that much, but they had to draw like Pictionary, play it with as Pictionary. And that's not easy if the word's a verb or is not a noun. And it went okay, but then later on in the year, I was doing another chapter, tried to always do something different each time. And we were reviewing after they had finished studying, like for the week, and the kids asked to do it. And I said, okay. And instead of me telling them the word, they thought I was gonna do that. And it was just nice because I said, no, you pick the word and draw whatever, you know, turned, I said, obviously it has to be okay to draw. But they took it and just ran with it, which was great, because it was vocabulary. Seems boring. Vocabulary is boring, just learn this word. But they were looking at the word in a picture, which helped them understand the word. So I really loved it when they asked to do it. They were like, I want to do what you did before. So we did hangman with vocabulary and things like that. But asking them to figure it out sometimes too, they were able to be creative and try. And sometimes in that case, the kid who everybody thinks can't do it actually can.
And I think it's the same, isn't it? It's like if you've got a child, for example, who, you know, because English language for a child, it can come across as a bit monotonous, can't it? You know, you feel like it's something you've got to drive into them. You will put that full stop there, you know. But if it's a child, for example, who's interested in music, you know, it could be tailored to, let's write the lyrics of a song. You know, because if people enjoy something, they're far more likely to want to engage with it, aren't they? Yeah.
I teach ESL, and we do a lot of vocabulary as well. And something I've done with students is they write the word like on a whiteboard, and they kind of hold it up so everyone else can see it, but they can't. And they have to ask questions that are yes or no answers to figure out what the word is.
Well,
they loved
it. Yeah, really good.
I was going to ask, you know, we, as a legislator, you know, we spend a lot of money on education. I mean, and it frustrates me that we just fuss and fight and argue so much. It just drives me crazy. But I think it was Pam mentioned silos. I think it was you, was it you? And I do see a lot of disconnect in government, society. But one of the theories I've kind of had is like the third grade reading. I don't know if there's any third grade teachers, fourth grade teachers in here. But it just seems like, I know when I was in school, I hated school. I was rebellious. But has anybody seen any studies or other countries that are, you're studying and then you're going over here and you're writing music or you're learning or you're having to walk around a track and then come back and learn? Has anybody studied that? I mean, have y'all seen any studies where that's the comprehension is being absorbed, where you're breaking it up?
I can't recall it off the top of my head, but I know that they're definitely, I'm happy to take the details as well and forward this on, because I know I've got it saved somewhere. There is a study that clearly shows that subjects involving creativity like music done from an early age with students massively increases the potential for outcomes later. And it's all about this idea of, I think I alluded to it before, the idea of a relationship between like maths, for example, and music, this idea of ratios. You know, it might not be something you can, as a young person, you can articulate in that way, but it's something you understand. You know that that note is a third. You know there's a relationship, there's a harmony to it, because there are certain rules, you know, within the nature of reality, for example. You know, if you look at the center of a sunflower, you know, it's the same spiral as you'd see in the galaxies, for example. It's the same spiral that you'd find in DNA. You know, it's phi ratio. So there are these certain rules that, you know, our ears are attuned to. And I think, you know, exposure to things like music, for example, it conditions the brain, although condition maybe sort of sounds like the wrong word, really, but it conditions the brain to become open. You know, it's about conforming to creativity. It's these sort of, it's a different paradigm. You know, it's the way I see the brain, it's like a 3D printer. You know, a child who has bad behaviors, for example, like me in school, these are things that are like learned, aren't they? Do you know what I mean? We learn these bad behaviors over time. But the brain really is always changing. Synapses are always firing. And if you change a behavior, if you change that pattern of behavior by giving a pupil access to something different, whether it's music, art, the ability to express themselves, and you conform to creativity, so you build creativity into the workflow of education so that there's, you know, you're maximizing the exposure to it. The brain will start to, you know, will start to print these different pathways then, where you can start to think differently. You can synthesize ideas. It's like when people talk to me, for example, about, you know, people with special needs or people who come from a different culture or speak a different language. I really do believe in intuition. I believe that this synthesis of ideas can give insights into things that don't currently exist in the outside world, like the iWatch, for example, at one time. And the way I see things now is like I look at everyone like a reflection of myself. And I really do believe that. I believe that what I see on the outside of me is actually me. And I know, I only know I'm suffering because those outside me are suffering. If you think of the human body, you might have lungs, you might have the heart, you might have eyes, hair. All these things require completely different cells that look and function completely differently. But it's only when those cells function and work together as one does the body function as one. And what I believe we've got to do in the classroom is teach people that it's good to be different. It's good to share those different skills and work together as one entity. Whether that's on a class level or a school level or a societal level or on a global level, we really are just one organism. But the problem that is that we identify as an individual I'm separate from. And what's really exciting for me about creativity and art is that it allows us to express ourselves, you know what I mean? It allows us to like bring that out and share that with other people. Maybe you can't sort of, write and deliver a speech, or you can't do it this way, but maybe you can write a song and you can communicate with someone that way. Maybe there's someone who's nonverbal, maybe who suffers with autism and they can't speak, but they can put it down on paper and they can sort of draw a picture. Everyone's different, and I think it is just about creating an education system that really encourages that growth and that freedom to express yourself in whatever way you see fit, as long as you're not sort of, causing harm to anyone else in the process. So a lesson that has creativity then at the core: view problems from many angles, hearing different points of view, taking things apart and seeing how things work. One of the reasons I got into technology, and this goes back to my case, which a little bit of a funny story, my nan liked their gadgets when I was growing up, and she used to buy like video cameras and hi-fi systems, this, that, and the other. But me, I'd come along and be like, "Oh, this is really cool. I want to see inside it. I want to take it apart. I want to see how the speakers work." And she'd come back and she'd see all these people and she'd go absolutely crazy. She'd be like, "What have you done? What have you?" But now we laugh about it because she understands, and I think then she understood as well that like, it's okay to be different, to do things a different way, to want to understand. And she did, she saw that gift in me that I wanted to understand. And she sort of nurtured me to do more of it. I'm sure she used to leave things out on purpose at some point. So she'd always say, "You better put it back together." But ironically, she's still got like half put together video cameras and RAM sticks and computers and all kinds all over the house. Reason, analyze, and brainstorm. This idea of brainstorming is all about quantity really over quality. It's about getting down as much as we possibly can. I think this is something that's really good in classrooms as well. The idea of, giving people the time to brainstorm ideas, to go through a subject and discuss a subject based on the knowledge that they've got. Just put it all out on paper and do it as a class exercise so that people can sort of share concepts together. And you're moving forward a little bit, exploring gut feelings. This is this idea of intuition. Rearrange components, ironically, like I was just saying, of old solutions to create new ones. This is the synthesis of ideas, again, that I think alluded to Steve Jobs. Use the non-rational parts of the brain. This is what art is. Visualize and use mental imagery. Collaborate and learn from others. Apply basic ideas and concepts and take risks and build self-confidence. Become more tolerant of the unknown and become more open to new experiences. Thoughts from Reimagine by Tom Peters outlines a need to develop a school that believes in, it says here, sort of learning is natural, but I think it goes a step further than that. Learning is natural, but learning is something really that should never stop. I think the day you stop wanting to learn is really the day you die. A love of learning is normal. When I was in school, if you wanted to learn, you were called a SWAT. I don't actually know what it means. I don't even know if it's an acronym. All I know is it's a word that was that described people who were the teacher's pet. SWAT. And it was like the peer group would criticize. If you put yourself forward and put your head above the parapet and you wanted to learn, you were criticized. You were brought down a peg or two by the group. So you had to be very discreet. I used to just sort of sit there, and rather than put my hand up and ask a question, I'd go home and, like, in the early days of American Online, you know, the, you've got mail. And I'd go on and, like, get on the computer and, like, Google things and stuff. But I think it's about really sort of creating that environment in school and making it really clear and using examples of people like Simon Cowell and Steve Jobs to show, you know, it's good to learn, it's good to express, and it's also good to fail again. Creativity is more important than fact recognition, and individuality is more important than conformity. Creative experiences build brain capacity. This goes back to this idea of the brain being like a 3D printer. You know, the more we change the way someone thinks, the more we change the makeup and the fabric of the brain. So we've first got to identify what types of people do we want to build for the future. And based on the idea of Bard and the reemergence of all these new technologies, the people that we needed yesterday are not going to be required tomorrow. But then as teachers, you know, how do we see what is required to, you know, tomorrow? How do we know what's going to be coming along the road in like 5, 10, 15, 20 years? I read a quote the other day, and I can't remember who it was off the top of my head, but they were saying, you know, in the next 14 years, there's going to be an exponential sort of curve of technology and artificial intelligence. And we're at crisis point because of AI. Machines in the next 20 years are going to do everything. So what are humans actually going to do? What are we going to do? I think machines can do a lot of good things in terms of building logic. Once we connect AI to quantum computers as well, that's going to go to a whole other level because, you know, we're at the point then where a bit like the human brain, which is essentially like a quantum computer that has these little vortices in there based on the same maths we discussed earlier, this spiral. You know, it's these vortices in the brain that create this quantum way of thinking. But quantum computers can't do one thing. They can't feel. They don't have emotion. They don't really know what human beings want. They think they know what they want based on the history of information that's stored on the internet, but human beings evolve. And it's the evolution of human beings that creates the next generation of technology. So these people, I believe, in my opinion, these people that think that AI and these machines are going to take over, I think are completely wrong. The machines and AI needs to be subservient, but it's about creating the next generation of children that can grow into adults, that can come up with new concepts of how we can use this technology, this software and this hardware to benefit people. The most important developments in civilization have come through the creative process, but ironically, most people have not been taught to be creative. Robert Fritz. As teachers, we have one of the largest potential influences on the children's willingness to take a risk and be creative. We can either support or thwart that creativity. And I thought this was quite an interesting diagram. I expect you all to be independent, innovative, critical thinkers who do exactly as I say. There's an irony in it, isn't there? Do you know what I mean? And I think just to kind of close on that, I'd like to maybe have a bit of a discussion and sort of kind of hand the floor back to anyone who'd like to kind of make some points or... Because I think really this is about learning from each other. It's okay me talking and kind of creating a topic of creativity, but really, you know, you guys are out in the field, you know what works and what doesn't. You know children, you know how creativity works in the classroom. And, you know, one person's probably got a really good idea that another person could benefit from. So if you just want to sort of take maybe, you know, 10 minutes or so, or however long's left, maybe 25 minutes, and just sit around the table and just sort of meet and greet each other and just share concepts of what you think works in the class, and then just maybe move around the room. But in terms of my presentation and what I'm here to talk about, I'm finished unless there's any questions. Thank you.
I have a question. So standardized, we have standards now. So we have, so if a student moves from Oregon to Tennessee, they're kind of on the same page. And so states kind of took back and they claimed their own standards, but they still sort of stayed the same. The difference that educators have always said is the more standards you have, the less creativity you have, the more you're on this timeline to check the boxes. But because we want consistency with students so they can move around and not lose learning opportunities, we've created more and more standards. And then they get even more specific down to I can statements. So the standards unpacked for you in a sense. And now it's like, okay, I really want to do this. I teach social studies and science. So I want to do this aquarium experience. I want them to understand the whole life cycle of the oxygen and that. But it, because of time, because I have so many standards, we find ourselves saying, okay, hold the bottle like this, put the rocks in like this, put the water, put the minnows in like this, and guiding them so much because of the standards. Do you see any way to, do you see any, I know you got more of a world perspective, other places in the world that have realized that the standards are kind of restricting, or do you see that that's the trend towards the future?
I think for me, like in terms of standards, it's sort of like this idea of, because effectively it's like creating laws, isn't it? It's like creating a set of laws to abide by, you know, and we create laws within society to create boundaries. It's this idea of a framework again, you know, because like the clematis that sort of grows, you know, up the trellis, it does need a framework. There needs to be a framework, but if the framework is there, is inhibiting the growth, and the framework clearly needs to change, as you say. I think in my experience of sort of, you know, looking at sort of frameworks and looking at the standardization process, I think it's about looking at it in terms of, is this actually benefiting people or not? And how do we communicate that back? It's about in the school environments, you know, within the management team, maybe, you know, creating a framework where people can discuss these ideas and this information can be fed back so that it can be acted upon. Because, I mean, am I right in thinking you're thinking that the standardization is actually inhibiting learning in some way?
Yeah, and in certain subject areas, you can actually get your hand slapped if you go outside of the boundary.
Yeah.
Like, you're literally in our district supposed to teach one reading course. So reading teachers, some friends of mine, at a teacher, they were adding in some extra creative stuff and adding in creativity, and they got in trouble.
Well, isn't this though why it's really important to be creative as teachers though as well? It's like earlier on when we were talking in the main hall and Dr. Talwar, I mean, Pam Lewis said about the idea that we don't necessarily pray in schools. But Dr. Talwar, when I did an affirmation, I mean, I don't really know what the difference there is, because it is essentially the same thing. And I think it's about being creative with the way we work. If we are passionate, if you really do believe that there is a difference, there is always a way to sort of work that in. You know, it's not a prayer, it's an affirmation. So for me, it's just semantics a lot of the time with this. Like, my mind doesn't compute in the same way. I like to sort of overcome challenges and break out of convention and do things outside the box. That doesn't work for me. When I see a system like that, I automatically want to break it like the camera, because I want to know what's inside it, you know. And it's not necessarily a bad thing, because even if it's wrong, I learn from the failure, you know. And then, so I think it is, but I think just to address the points, I think like in terms of the frameworks, I think that it does need to be addressed by teachers and people who understand it in the classroom like yourselves. I think that is really, really important.
Yeah, to kind of piggyback off of that, I think it also depends on the school, the admin, and the district, because I've worked at a school that, yes, was very structured, you can't deviate, but now I'm at schools where the principal's just like, as long as they're learning, do whatever you want. And it's one of the top high schools, so
the proof's in the pudding.
Yeah,
that's because you're being creative and they're engaged and they're doing well. So,
because sometimes as a teacher, when you say something, all you learn is don't say anything.
Yeah.
No, there
yeah.
are schools that are like that where. Yeah, and that's what is hard, because you then have to. It's not always easy to move schools either, but I mean there are some books and schools that give you the script on how to say the math lesson. It physically has a script, and if you gear off that and don't do it, gives you everything, you can get in trouble.
I know that there's so many standards and those ICANN statements, but there are so many paths that students can take to show their understanding, to show what they know. And I'm speaking from the elementary level, so I was a classroom teacher and I'm an instructional coach now. And some of my most impactful lessons and aha moments for students has been working with our specialty teachers, you know, working with our music teachers, art teachers, et cetera, to dive into those standards and whatnot, but to create those impactful lessons for those students. And even now I encourage my teachers to work with our specialty teachers to see how they can support one another.
And it's always good to do like a project sometimes. I've not been able to do it in the past because of trying to catch up with everything that we lost with COVID. But in the past, if I was doing something like statistics and probability, instead of just teaching the same old thing over and over again, make the kids do a project with it, and they're doing a presentation, so they're doing ownership of it. They're showing that they can do that. They can tell the difference between a biased and an unbiased question because that's what they're having to do. But they need to know that information to go out and ask other classrooms those questions that they're gonna do in, you know, collecting the data and then doing, tell me which one is the best way to present your data. Is it a circle graph because it's a percentage of a whole? Or is it a histogram or, you know, just different things like that. They're getting the whole picture, but they're doing different projects. You can do it one-on-one, you know, one child do it each, and they could do it on a board and display it. And I'm getting the same knowledge. They're hitting every single standard. They can still say, I can do this, I can do that, and I can do that. But it's a project. Lately, because of COVID, I'm just trying to scramble and catch everybody up because they lost so much. But now that we seem to have been caught up, I'm trying to get back into do project-based and creative things like that.
And sometimes you should do things that, like if there's a, quote, problem in school. Our sixth graders this year complained they didn't have enough time to switch classes, that it wasn't enough time. So the science teacher had them do an experiment on it, and they each had to do it and figured out things and timed things, and they all came back with, oh, it is enough time. We're taking too long doing X and Y and meeting at the bathroom. But it would help them. They were complaining about, we don't have enough time to switch classes. We turned it back over to them and said, okay, let's see whether you do or don't, really. And because like one of the rooms was like the art room is on the other side of the building. So, but it was great because then they were able to solve it themselves and see, oh, we do, which was good because I don't think they were going to get a change in the class time switch.
Is there a platform, a teacher's platform, where you could share all this information amongst each other so people who are finding it difficult to...
Teacher pay teacher?
So I have a comment here. So that principal at the school where the teachers got in trouble, he was letting them do it.
Right.
And it was a parent who came in, and this are legislators I think need to pay attention, because when a parent came in and said, you're not doing what the rule is, went to the county, even went to the state school board and reported them, and they came back from the top like, oh, you've got to follow this rule. One time I was being observed and I was doing a math introduction and I went 12 minutes instead of 10 minutes. And the format at that moment said it was supposed to only go up to 10 minutes. I got marked down and she changed it. But I talked to the state commissioner of the chair for the education department. And I said, I got marked down for going 2 extra minutes. Like we were in a one-on-one conversation. She said, that was never the intent of the law to hold you to an exact minute, but because the law was written to an exact minute, we're being held to that. So I feel like from the legislative perspective, they need to loosen that so that we have some freedom because it's written in such a way that parents can go, there's this law you're not following. All of a sudden the principal that was allowing creativity and allowing this greatness to happen in the classroom, he got in trouble, the teacher got in trouble, the district came down on them, coming from the state down, and you're like, stop with these specific laws that are restricting creativity.
And I think this is that, but without having that law there in the first place, we wouldn't have anything to challenge, you know, and this is the thing about sort of, you know, challenging law and working with legislators and why that is so important, because it's about working together to overcome the challenges that you're all feeling, to make it better for students' outcomes. And that's the bottom line. You know, if we all work together in that way, I identified something that I think is sort of a bit of a phenomenon worldwide, really. Like since the pandemic, people do seem to be suffering worse with the mental health. There is a pandemic, it's documented, there's data, it's really clear evidence to show that. So I started thinking about it and working with Dr. Talwar and Anna and obviously Pam Lewis and the team. We're all together. And I was thinking, hang on. We don't actually have as much mental health support in schools as what I thought we did have. I just assumed there would be trained people who could deal with these issues. And it wasn't until there was a unbelievably tragic shooting over at the Covenant School, and obviously Dr. Talwar and Pam went over there to address that and work with some of the teachers and the parents and the children, I think, as well, that I started to think, you know, and this is sort of just indicative again of nurturing that creativity, you know, early on, because then people can very quickly come up with solutions regardless of whatever the topic is. Because we very quickly started talking, and I said, hang on a minute, what if we created a covenants law? Why are we treating physical injury any different than we're creating mental injury, mental health? Why? If a child falls over and cuts the knee, we put a bandage on, it goes in the book. There's a process, there's a certain law, the standards that we have to follow to document it. But if there's a bullying incident, where's the mental plaster for that? Where's the accident book for that? You know, how's that documented? Where's the trend analysis to find out what impact bullying has on a macro scale in schools? So I say, well, hang on a minute. What if we worked with teachers or the current school nurses to give them accredited training to make them mental health practitioners in their own right, mental health first aiders? A first aider for mental health. This is an initial triage. This is something you or I could do. It's a very simple, maybe 1-2 day course that addresses all the core principles and gives you all of the key knowledge that you need to be able to address the mental health issues that come from something like a trauma, a death or bullying, for example. And then we thought, well, actually, let's take it a step further. If you've got these people getting this mental health data, putting it into a system, you could then go a step further and have a team centrally looking at the analytics. If something's going on in the media or something's happening out there, or, you know, say, for example, a certain event happens, or there's God forbid, there's another shooting, you can very quickly look at the data and have analysis on the mental health of people. It doesn't have to be related to names or ages. This can just be data that's accessible, you know, centrally, so that people can see, but it provides an infrastructure, a framework to build on later. But at the moment, there doesn't seem to be anything really like that for mental health. And I think it's just indicative, again, of this creative mind. You know, we can come up, it's problem solving. It's critical thinking and problem solving. And there's a lot of problems that need to be solved. But if we were all a little bit more creative, maybe we wouldn't have quite as many problems.
Maybe AI can also help the laborious work that you have to, you know, that's going to, if you can get that to your fingertips, but
AI will create lesson plans for you. If you insert the standard, your objectives, it will create a lesson plan for you.
Yeah.
I think it's important for everybody, you know, just adding on to what you said, and what you said, Daniels. Once upon a time, there was a song that came out. I mean, everyone's heard of Pink Floyd, yeah? Everyone's heard of Brick on the Wall. Everybody's heard of, we don't need no education. There was a time at that moment, you know, what was going on worldwide. And it doesn't help when you've got AI. And when you discuss this, you know, kids can just say, I can do this. What do I need a teacher for? What do I need a school for? And that's why when you have a teacher that's you know, showing empathy, we have a teacher in a school that's uplifting them, showing the human touch, you know, so like encouraging the creativity. That is something that they will say, do you know what? I need the school, I need the teacher, I need this education. And that counters the AR situation, what you're talking about. And that counters everything. Otherwise, ladies and gentlemen, there will be another Pink Floyd and there will be another Brick in the Wall. But again, this is the situation that we're in now because we just don't know. Nobody knows. You know, many people are saying that AI is like, it has a more catastrophic sort of situation, more than climate change, for example. Nobody knows the answer for that. You know, we don't know the answer, but what we do have is what we have in our hands, the human touch, and encourage creativity in schools.
But to go a little bit further again, it's like, you know, you create tools to create tools to create tools. AI really is just the latest tool. And then I mean, think about, if we think about it, like, you know, what are we going to use AI for? What's the possibilities? I mean, there's traffic mapping, there's predictions of weather. When you connect it to quantum computers, it's going to be able to process vastly more amounts of information. So, like, you know, the next generation are going to need to use all this equipment and all this software and algorithms and hardware. But what are they going to use it for? How are they going to apply it? Well, that's being creative with the tools that you're given. So again, it's just nurturing that creativity is so important, because it's not about giving up because, oh, well, AI can do it, as you say. You know, it's about what can we use the AI to do in the generation ahead.
It's a tool. You use it as a tool.
It's a tool, yeah. It's
our
no
friend
more than
Trey Bruce uses it.
Yeah.
And he's been using it for years. And it's great if you're on a deadline. It
yeah.
really helps you be on a deadline.
Just to touch on that for a second, you know, before we finish. I mean, what's has anyone had any experience of using AI or like related to the classroom?
I've used it to create tests, like quizzes, because I'm a math teacher, and so instead of coming up with like my own numbers and variables, just put it in there and it spit out a few good quizzes for me.
A nice idea, yeah.
I'm curious, and are you getting any pushback in your classrooms, and maybe kids are not even aware of this, about quote-unquote banned books, and where does that stand in your classes? Are the kids wanting to read the book because they're supposed to not, they're not going to be able to read the book? It's almost like back in the day, banned in Boston, and it created more of a demand for the books because it was banned in Boston. Or is that like a non-issue?
So what Tennessee has recently done is they passed a law that all books in public school libraries need to be scanned so parents can see the list. But then the State Board of Education took it a step further, which was not the intent of the law. Again, this is a law creating its own dilemmas. Now all the teachers are having to scan all of their own books in their classroom libraries. If you read a book, add a book, you have to have scanned it so parents can see what books you have in your library. Then the parents have the ability, like you said, to push against it if they don't like a book that you have. But what it did cause is most of the teachers, especially in the upper grades, packed their boxes up. I had one friend who just gave away all her books. She literally sold them or gave them all away. And it's the younger teachers that are taking the time to scan in 1,500 books, but that's the Tennessee law now. And the State Board of Education bumped it up to all classrooms have to scan all books.
So if you, let's just say you're gonna teach Mark Twain, okay? And Tom Sawyer, Huck Finn, you know, the N-word is in his books. This is one everybody knows about. And maybe you're teaching race relations based on that book, but if you've got a parent who has a problem with their child reading Huck Finn, what do you do with that child? I mean, that child's not learning the same thing that the rest of the classroom is. I mean, how do you do that?
They can opt out of a book. So the school district I'm in, and I don't teach reading, but on my team there was someone teaching that. There were certain books that the school district went through with an advisory board, and they literally put post-it notes over the sections they were going to skip because some of the books had some content that was not appropriate for the grade level I was teaching. So they literally just told them like to skip over those words or pages or paragraphs.
Wow. You can buy that book now without the word too, which I don't agree with. I'm just
saying. Yeah, I get it. I know what you're saying.
But isn't it a scary thought as well?
But this goes back to what you said earlier about squashing creativity, isn't it?
Well, it is, but I think someone made a comment, and no.
You also have to give them an alternate assignment.
Yeah, that's what I was going
to
say.
As a teacher, you have to do that.
That will cover the same material.
Or the same topics and so forth.
But sadly, there's some reason for it, though. There are some teachers who have pushed agendas.
Yeah.
And have pushed it over the top. And so if you wouldn't have those, you know, 1% of teachers that were being un-age appropriate in their teaching, none of this would have happened. You've got those few people that are more radical, whichever direction they go.
They have an agenda.
Yeah, and that caused the law to be written because they exist.
But that's a small percentage. I see.
Just to come back to that point, because I really do think it's so crucial. Like this idea of technology emerging, I don't think anyone really understands, including myself, like the implications of it over the next 10 years. It's going to be vastly different, hugely. And I think Dr. Talwar hit the nail on the head when he said, the most important thing really is teaching care and compassion. Because if we don't raise people who care about their fellow neighbor and people who are compassionate to others, we're not going to raise a generation who are going to use this technology for the right means, and that terrifies me the most.
Well, it could be weaponized.
Well, yeah, well, it probably already is.
I mean, part of my instruction is to, like, I do ESL.
It is being weaponized. You could print guns.
You can print gun parts, yeah. Probably print ammunition by now.
We're getting into discussion on guns, and I'm like, at this point, you can print one on them.
But it's not the weapons being created by the AI that worries me. It's the AI being in control of the weapons, and the AI will be able to create, you know, machines that can be, you know, can create machines. So there's going to come a time when, it's going to go so much further that the machines will be able to create their own machines. That sounds like sci-fi. It's not. It's happening right now.
It's Terminator and Wall-E.
It is literally Terminator, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Wall-E as well.
As a legislator, I was elected in 2010, and I've watched our prison budget double. It's $1.2 billion now. And I'll be honest with you, I've never had a lobbyist come in my office. JC, you can attest this. No one's ever came in and said, Mike, we got to get the prison budget down. We got to change lives. I've never seen it. Yeah. I have a theory that this stuff is done on purpose to create chaos, to create confusion, to create, because it ain't really a Republican Democrat. Mm-hmm. It's about what's right and what's wrong. Speaking of critical thinking, we asked for some money in the budget to hit 4 or 5 school districts, I think, to try to teach critical thinking in the schools and juvenile detention facilities, maybe the alternative schools. We did, our property assessor of all people did get a grant for $5,000. He'd seen a guy on Twitter, that guy, I think they call him the Prophet. He's owns, I think it's one of the big outdoor stores. Some of y'all may know the TV show, it's called The Prophet. He was on TV. But Rob Mitchell just applied. He got $5,000 on grant. But the theory I've got is, man, where do you learn? Where do these kids, that, especially males, that are just so quick to get in a fight, to retaliate? You know, we're seeing school shootings at a graduation, heartbreaking, people killed in their cap and gown. I mean, where's the discussion at? This, not only is it angers me, I mean, it's sad where you're seeing the hurts and stuff, but where is this stuff being talked about? Because you know, nobody's going to talk about Gandhi or Jesus in the school system, unless you're in a private school system. Where do you learn critical thinking? Where do you learn to be kind to your fellow man? I mean, what classes?
I mean, maybe there is. I mean, I wouldn't define myself as like Christian in that sense. Like, I believe in all faiths. In fact, I believe in faith. You know, it's not like the idea of a faith. I believe in faith. I believe in something greater than myself. So, like, the way I see it is different to other people within faith. But I think there is a correlation between this idea of kind of removing and eradicating faith because of a small minority of people who take it to the nth degree, with the rise in crime, the breakup of the family, and increased prison populations. I think what we've got to do is we've got to go back. We've got to understand. I mean, I hate to use another biblical phrase, but we've got to know thyself. What are we really? If we go back to that example before about this idea of cells in the body, most people now, they're a blood cell thinking, I'm going to get out of this body, you know, I'm just going to go, and they don't care that it's going to be self-destructive anyway. They're really not that bothered because it's about quick fixes. So I think it is about this idea of unity and bringing people together and teaching this to children so that at a school level they understand they're part of something much greater, but it's something to be really proud of, and it's something that you can influence if you work hard in school, you know.
Speaking of influence, one of the teachers over here mentioned the state law, but speaking, and I've heard the word silo, I see it all the time. I mean, we never, as lawmakers, I mean, JC invited me here. I meet with legal at 1 about my gun safe bill, some other issues, and I just asked them to put it off till 2 today. But, you know, we've got to communicate. I do a radio show on Sunday nights, and I had Tennessee Firearms, JC knows them. They can be a fiery brand over here. And then I had Dr. Brian Terry with me, and I had somebody else, I think, call in, talk about mental health in these areas. That's where we heard about Bill Beck that passed away. We had a lawmaker die literally we were on the radio and he got that text, and Brian about got kind of choked up on the air. But there is silos that we don't communicate. But I quoted that Cool Hand Luke phrase, what we have here is fair to communicate. But communicate with your lawmakers, and I guarantee you JC does. In fact, he probably, just to be blunt, he probably pisses people off a lot, don't you? But you know, we kind of, yeah. We need that. Yeah. We need that, but yeah. Write your lawmakers, and write it like you're writing a fifth grader. I mean, seriously. Plenty of bullet points, real simple, because we got so much coming at us.
Sure.
I mean, I got to be at a funeral later. I got all this stuff going on, but make it real simple. A little card and write your representative. Don't matter if it's a Democrat, Republican. Invite them to your classroom. Talk to your school superintendent. Talk to your principal. Get them there. Cause we don't know these things until you know, we hear from a teacher. But I'll tell you what alarms me on the library. I watched it was a video of the day. I guess it's a Facebook reel or something. And it was a father, and he just quoted. He just was blunt. Said everything that book said. And it was some pretty nasty crap. And I'm thinking, why is this in the school system? Who's got an agenda? I mean, is this being manifested on purpose? It worries lawmakers. You know, we start hearing from parents. So that makes us want to do something. Sometimes you go take a sledgehammer and bust a wall. You're trying to kill an ant or something. And if we go too far with things. But that's why we have to have the discussion, you know.
We could talk at length about all this stuff, I'm sure, yeah. Topic I enjoy debating, yeah. But yeah, no, I think it's 12 o'clock as well, everyone, so I'm guessing everyone wants to go. But thanks so much for coming, and I've really enjoyed this. Very nice to meet you all as well. Thank you.